Okay, guys, I will actually go through this topic in a very fast manner. So atomic structure and ionization energy. So for atomic structure, we need to know that, okay, if you have X, okay, and then we try to write down, okay, like for example, A and Z. So A is actually the one on top is going to be the nucleon number. The one at the bottom is going to be the proton number. So if they ask you, what is the number of protons? So we look at the number of proton from the Z. So for example, if I have sodium, okay, so we know that the proton number is going to be 11, and our electron number should be in the neutral atom should be the same as the number of protons, so it should be also 11. And then the nuclear number over here for sodium is going to be 23. But if you want to find the number of neutron, okay, the number of neutron, we have to actually take the 23 minus 11 and you are going to get 12. That's going to be number of neutron. Now the next part that we need to actually remember is isotopes. What are the isotopes? Isotopes are atoms of the same element with different nuclear number. So when we say same element, it means they must have the same number of proton. So they have different number of nucleon, okay, number, which is going to be different number of neutron. Okay, so if you look of example of chlorine 35 and 37, so the proton number is going to be 17. The proton number is going to be 17, but if you look at the electron, they are also going to be the same, which is 17 and 17. But the neutron, okay, is on the other hand, is going to be different. So 35 minus 17 is going to be 18. Okay, and then 37 minus 17, you are going to get 20. So there are different number of neutron over there. So it is going to have, okay, the same chemical property, because chemical property depends on the number of electrons. So they will have, isotopes have the same chemical property, but they have different physical property. So if we go on for the electronic configuration, okay, we have to actually learn that under electronic configuration, we have three things that we need to remember, which is going to be the principal quantum shell and subshells, okay, which is going to be divided into S, P, D, and F, and also the atomic orbitals. Okay, so the principal quantum shell is going to be given number 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Okay, with the lowest number, okay, will indicate that they are actually closer to the nucleus, and the highest number will indicate that they have the they're further away from the nucleus. So each of the subshells, okay, they do have their own shape. Okay, like for example, S subshell, they have a spherical shape. P subshells, they have a dumbbell shape, like something like this. And each orbital, okay, the within the subshell, we have different subshells. Like for example, S subshell, they have only one orbital. Okay, one orbital. For P subshells, they have three orbitals. So each orbital can actually supply can accommodate maximum of 2 electron. So P, okay, can actually accommodate, because they have 3 orbitals, okay, so they accommodate 3 times 2, so they accommodate total of 6 electrons. For D, okay, they have 5 orbitals, so 5 times 2, you have 10 electrons. And F, they have 7 orbitals, so they can accommodate total of 14 electrons. So this one, we need to know. This is some of the basics that you need to know about electronic configuration. Now, for example, if I want to write the electronic configuration for sodium 281, we cannot actually write it now in this form. So we need to write it down in this SPD form. So you will have 1s2, okay, 2s2, okay, followed by 2p6, and then followed by 3s1, okay. So take note, okay, every single time when we fill in the electrons, okay, we need to actually fill in to the orbitals or the shells that is actually lower energy first, then we fill up with the higher energy. So it means that, okay, the 1s is lower energy compared to 2s, then we actually increase in energy. So they are going to be further away. We need to have more energy to fill in. Okay, so we also need to, when you are removing the electrons, it does also work in that way. So we will go through it later. So we remove it, okay, from the lower energy, but it's going to be slightly different. You remove from the outermost shell, yeah. So that's going to be different. Now, do remember, okay, this one is something we need to remember, like when you are filling up the electronic configuration. So after 3p, we are not going to actually get 3d. Like for example, 1s, okay, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. After that, 3s2, then 3p6, and after that, don't actually fill up to 3d. Okay, you have to fill up 4s2, then you follow 3d. So this one is very important. So this part, okay, we need to actually remember where which one we need to fill first. The reason is because when we have a difference in the energy level, so when we actually look at it, like for example 1s is actually lower energy level compared to 2 and 3, but when they split, okay, what happens is the 4s happen to be something like similar to 3d. The energy level is almost similar, so it happens that 4s, okay, will actually have a lower energy level compared to 3d. So we actually fill up 4s first, compare then only we fill up 3d. And when we remove, also when we remove the electron, we always remove the 4s before 3d. This one you just remember, okay? So 4s, okay, is a special case, 4s and 3d. But there is a rule, or there is a way how to remember this. So this one, like for example, if you have 1s, you fill up 1s first, then followed by 2s, followed by 2p, then followed by 3s, followed by 3p, straight away after 3p, not 3d, so it's going to be 4s. Once you finish 4s, then you go for 3d, then you follow with 4p and so on. So this one is some kind of a something similar on how we get this, okay? So the next one, okay, is going to be related to ionization energy. What are ionization energy? Okay, when you remove one electron from each atom in one mole of atoms, but they must be in gaseous state, okay? So you are going to actually require energy. When we are trying to remove the electrons from atom, we need to supply energy. So it's supposed to be an endothermic reaction. So this is the equation. Like for example, you want to remove, so this is going to be the equation for the first ionization energy. Take note that this ionization energy, you can keep on removing the electrons until there is no more electrons left. But do remember, when we remove the electrons, the ionization energy, it must be in gaseous form. So it is very difficult to remove the electron when they are in solid form or liquid form. So it must be in gaseous form. So take note of that. So the next one is, let's actually learn about the factors affecting ionization energy. There are total three factors affecting ionization energy. One is the size of the nucleus charge. And second is going to be the distance of the outer electrons with the nucleus, and then the shielding effect of the inner electrons. Okay, so when you have a greater nuclear charge, of course, the nucleus will have a strong attraction towards the electron. So generally, when proton increases, yeah, the strength of the nucleus will be more to attract the electron. So that's going to be affecting the ionization energy. But as they keep on going away, okay, when the outer electron, actually there is a distance, so this distance from the nucleus will play a part as well. When you have more distance from the nucleus, let's say it's far away, and then you have this one as nucleus and the outer electron is quite near, it is understood that the attraction towards the electron, okay, for the one that is nearer is going to be more compared to the attraction. Let's say if I try to actually draw like they try to pull the electron, okay, they cannot actually have a very good attraction, okay, of the electrons, okay. So the distance, okay, actually makes the ionization energy to become lower, okay. And then we also have something what we call a shielding effect. It's like when you have a lot of inner electrons and there's a lot of shells, okay, so this will actually decrease the attraction, the nuclear attraction towards the electron. So when you have a lot of shells, we say that there's a lot of shielding effect. So therefore, we have the ionization energy is going to be much more lower, okay, it's easier to remove the electron, okay. So the next part, as I told you before, okay, you can remove the electron until there's no electrons left. So for example, sodium is 11, so you can remove all the 11 electrons. But take note, okay, there is a big jump when you actually have a look over here, from to remove 1 to 2. Why? Because when you remove the one electron from here, okay, so the next electron, you are removing it from the number 2, which is going to be principal quantum shell that is much more closer to the nucleus. So it's going to will have a greater attraction, the nuclear attraction, and then it's going to be difficult to remove. That's why there is a big jump. But when they are in the same principal quantum shell, okay, so from to remove the electrons from second electron to ninth electron, there's a gradual increase. Why there is increase? That's very important also. The increase is because when you keep on removing the electrons, the proton will be more than the electron. So of course, the charge, okay, is going to be more. So of course, it's going to be much more difficult to remove. But there is a gradual increase until you want to actually remove the next electron, which is going to be way closer to the nucleus, which is going to be from 1s2. So you can see that to remove the 10th electron is going to be difficult. So there is a big jump over there. Okay, so this one is very important. So basically, we are talking about the distance. Okay, the distance, and in this case, the distance will actually kind of outweigh the kind of nuclear increase in the nuclear charge. So it's going to be not away. I think the distance here is going to become much more closer to the nucleus. So it's going to be way difficult to remove the electron. So nothing to do with the shielding effect and so on. I think it's actually much more difficult. It's going to be difficult to remove. But we need to actually take note of this big increase over here. Okay, the next part, okay, is going to be the patterns of ionization energy across the periodic table and the patterns of ionization energy going down the periodic table. So when you go across the periodic table, we need to know that the atomic radius is going to become smaller and smaller. Okay, why the atomic radius becoming smaller and smaller? I think this one, increase in proton number will actually make the nuclear charge to be more. We have the same shielding effect, okay, because they are from the same period. So they are going to actually pull the electrons and the shells to become much more closer. So the radius will generally go down. So when the radius getting smaller and smaller, so it means it's going to be difficult to remove the electron from the smaller atom compared to the one that is going to be bigger atom. So it's going to be, you can see that the ionization energy is going to be increased. But when it's going down the group, we know that the as you go down, you are going to have different number of shell, addition of shells. So when you have addition of shells, okay, even though we know that the proton number is increasing as you go down the group, but we know that the ionization energy depends not only the proton, it also depends on the distance and the shielding effect. In this case, the distance and the shielding effect, okay, the distance and shielding effect is going to outweigh the increase in the nuclear charge, okay, or the proton. So it's going to be outweigh. So it's going to be, the distance is going to play a bigger role. The shielding effect is going to play a bigger role over here, where it's going to be much more easier to remove those electrons. And that's why we have, as you go down the periodic table in a group, okay, the ionization energy is going to decrease. And when you look at the, let's say across the periodic table, let's say increase in number of proton, so we can actually have some kind of trend. Like for example, the, let's say this is going to be hydrogen, so that's going to be one, okay, so helium, so you can see the sudden increase, and then suddenly there is a big drop over here. And we can see there is another big drop over here. What we can see is going to be from helium and neon. Okay, neon is going to be group 18. So take note, whenever there is a big jump, okay, we will notice that this is going to be group 1 and this is going to be group 1. So the one that actually, when you have such a, let's say you are arranging the first ionization energy across the, let's say for example, atomic number and so on. So if you notice that the highest, okay, you have highest ionization energy and there is a drop, that indicates that this is going to be group 18 and this one will be group 1. Okay, so we can actually generally see that. So this one is also group 18, so this one is group 1, and we can conclude that this is going to be group 17 as well. But if you look at this graph, okay, generally we do expect, okay, from the same period, we do expect that the graph should be going up, okay, because the proton number is increasing, okay, and the size is actually getting smaller and smaller. We do expect the ionization energy to increase, but there is going to be a special case when it comes to beryllium and boron and nitrogen and oxygen. So let's actually look at the special case over here. For beryllium and boron, this is going to be the electronic structure, and then boron, there is an electronic structure over there. It is found that to remove this particular electron from boron, okay, it's going to be much more easier because this electron is actually situated in the 2p, which is even though they're from the almost the same energy level, okay, it is still further from the nucleus. So it's easier to remove this particular electron compared to removing one electron from beryllium. So it's going to be easier. So that's why there is a drop from beryllium to boron. Okay, so 2p is actually further from the nucleus, so easier to remove. So that's why I've wrote over there distance and shielding. Okay, there will be more distance, okay, kind of more distance for 2p, and then there will be more, a little bit more of shielding. And even though there is an increase in nuclear charge, but they will outweigh the increase in nuclear charge, causing the ionization energy for boron to be slightly lower than expected compared to beryllium. And for N and O, nitrogen and oxygen, so this is going to be the electronic configuration for both of them. So if I draw this in a box form for 2p3, so electron will be arranged in an unpaired manner first, okay? And then you can see that for here, 2p4, so you arrange according to unpaired manner as well. And then you have one electron over there, which is paired over here. So when you want to remove the electron, so I remove the electron over here. But when I want to remove the electron that I circle red over here will be removed. And this is going to be coming from the paired electron, which is going to be from the paired shell, paired orbital, okay, from the paired orbital. So they are going to be easily removed compared to removing the electron in a singly filled manner. Because when you have in a paired orbital, there will be some kind of a greater repulsion to remove that electron that is being paired. They don't want to stick together, so they want to actually repel. So it's much more easier to remove this particular electron, therefore making the ionization energy for the first ionization energy for the oxygen to be much more lower than expected, and it's not actually greater than nitrogen. So this situation, or this thing, we call it as spin pair repulsion. Okay, that's all the summary for this chapter. Thank you, everyone.